Hey everyone, welcome to Cross Culture Critic. This is Chris Williams. Joe Yerkes is not with me today because, as you might be able to tell from the title of this episode, we have a very special interview for you. When I first started this podcast, as I've said before, I wanted it to be a series of interviews with people through the Christian music industry who were really big in the 90s, 2000s, in crafting the music that I listened to as a youth group kid. And the podcast has obviously evolved into something better and more fun and more extensive than I ever dreamed. And I'm so thankful for what this has become. But I still love doing these interviews. I loved our talk with Joe that kicked this whole thing off, with Reese Roper. There was another one that I was extremely excited about a few weeks ago that unfortunately the audio did not make it through. And I am bummed that you don't get to hear that. But when I sat down to think about who I wanted to interview for this show, one name near the top of the list was Steve Taylor. If you grew up listening to Christian music in the 90s and 2000s, there was a good chance that whatever you listened to was either recorded by Steve, produced by Steve, or written by Steve. His albums beginning in 1984 were Meltdown, On the Frit, I Predict 1990, Cheval Guevara, Squint. And he just put out in 2014 the album Goliath with The Perfect Foil, which is a fantastic album. I can't recommend any of those enough. They are fantastic. Even if you go back and listen to something like I Want to Be a Clone, his first EP, that is fantastic. He was a button pusher. He was a provocateur who not only spoke a lot of truth to non-believers, but pointed the finger back at the church. And he produced some of the most iconic albums in Christian rock. So I grew up listening to the Newsboys, Not Ashamed, Going Public, Take Me to Your Leader. He was very involved in all of those. He produced the Sixpence None the Richer album that had Kiss Me on it, which was one of the biggest things in Christian music for a while. He produced Scallyluia, which was put out by the Insiders and our own Joe Yerkes. So, I mean, he has been deeply involved in the Christian music scene. As a movie guy, I have also been really excited to see him as a filmmaker. He directed the Michael W. Smith film, The Second Chance, which is a much better film than you would expect from the faith-based industry. It's a little conventional, but definitely worth checking out because I think it hits on a lot of themes that are still really relevant. In 2012, he directed Blue Like Jazz, the adaptation of the popular Donald Miller book. And it is a great movie. It's not a great movie, but it is a great movie about faith. I highly recommend it. I think it is a lot of fun. It says some really important things. It is a movie that I think we need, especially right now. So I was really pleasantly surprised and excited when I emailed Steve, and he emailed back right away to say, yeah, I'll do this. I'm in. And we set up a date really quickly, and he could not have been nicer to talk to. This is a fun interview. I was so excited to talk to him. I had to really prevent myself from fanboying out because, I mean, I could have talked to him for 6 hours, but I didn't want to take up more than an hour of his time because he's just been involved with so much. He's a fantastic writer. He's very astute politically. He's got a really good eye as to what's going on in Christianity. He's passionate. He's a good filmmaker. I think you're going to like this interview. This is fun. This is exactly what I've been wanting from this podcast, and I am really excited for you to hear it. Before we get into that, just want to remind you, if you want to hear more interviews like this and you want them to be maybe a little bit better audio quality, consider supporting us. We have a Patreon page. You can give just a few a month, and you'll earn a lot of really cool bonus recordings, events, emails, the opportunity to ask us questions, a lot of really fun stuff for patrons on there. So check that out, the Patreon page. Consider giving a few bucks a month, and we greatly appreciate it. Everything goes right back into the show. I'll link to it in the show notes. Follow us on Twitter. Follow us on Facebook. Subscribe to us on iTunes. If you listen to us on iTunes, please give us a rating. That helps us get promoted a little bit more. But I think the most important thing you can do is listen, tell your friends, join in the discussion on Facebook. We really want to hear from you. So without any more delays, I'm going to get into this interview with Steve Taylor. I hope you love it. We will be back next week with another episode. Thank you very much. And here it is, Steve Taylor. Steve, how you doing, man?
I'm good, thank you. Here in Nashville, Tennessee, we're remnants of Hurricane Irma are just starting to arrive, but I think we're going to be fine.
Are you guys getting a ton of rain and wind there?
We are, yes, but, you know, nothing like what the Caribbean and Florida had to endure, so it's not an issue here.
Yeah, I was seeing someone post online. I live in Detroit, and it just seems like you had Harvey and Irma, and out west there's fire, and it's like, oh, this is like the one time where you want to say, yeah, I'm glad to live in Detroit.
Yeah, right.
So it's 75 and sunny here, so.
Like the seven horsemen of the apocalypse happening in the last few weeks.
Yeah, and us in Detroit, we had our apocalypse 50 years ago, so.
That's right.
So, yeah, I listened to the interview you did with Cultivated a few weeks ago. I think I found out it was airing, like, the day after we had confirmed this, and I was like, oh, he beat me. But yeah, I'm excited to talk to you. I grew up listening to Christian music. My dad was he was the music guy at our church, not really a music minister, but he led all the music. So I grew up pretty much in the 90s and 2000s only listening to Christian music. So
right.
You've touched a lot of what I've listened to. I mean, you've been doing this for quite a while, and I just wonder if briefly you can give us a rundown of how you got started and kind of your first forays into the music industry.
Yes, my dad is a pastor, so I grew up in church. My dad has a really fine singing voice, and so there was always music around. And I don't have any particular abilities when it comes to playing instruments. I was a trombone player in junior high and high school, and not a particularly good one. But I like to sing, and I was actually really good at theory and composition. So ultimately, I could write charts out. I just couldn't play them myself. And when I was in college, I was really influenced by punk rock and new wave coming over from England, and started making demos of songs that I would write. There was a little studio in Denver where I would get friends together and we'd record the demos, and eventually got signed to a record deal.
All right. Yeah, and you were kind of known right off the bat as you weren't really following in the Michael W. Smith, Amy Grant grain, which actually I think you were out a little before them.
Yeah, like Amy came out had come out a few years earlier, and then Michael and I had albums come out pretty close to the same time. His first one might have come out a bit before mine.
Okay. Yeah, you kind of came right out of the gate as almost a provocateur, almost. You know, it's funny, you listen to a lot of Christian music, you know, from that time or even today, and it's very, you know, pro-church, go-church,
right.
And I just listening to some of your old stuff again a few weeks ago, or leading up to this interview, it's incendiary stuff, some of it. Like, it's funny if you read your Wikipedia page, how many times it mentions that Family Christian Stores pulled your album, or...
Right.
Was that kind of, or what led to that idea that, hey, I'm going to sing to the church, but I'm going to sing to the church?
Yeah, you know, it didn't really start off that way. I was just making music that I thought mattered to me and that I thought would be interesting, and it wasn't necessarily intended for a strictly Christian audience, but when I went to mainstream labels first, and I've told this story before, they tended to like the musical style, but they didn't know what to do with the lyrics. They were afraid that the, you know, Christian content might offend their listeners. And then when I decided, well, I'll just try Christian labels, they let me know that they didn't like the music and that the lyrics would offend their listeners. And so that's pretty much where I've lived ever since.
Well, was that hard being in that middle ground, or was it kind of, yeah, no, this is where I need to be?
I mean, I was very happy with the label that signed me, Sparrow Records, was a great home, and really got into the spirit of things. I remember when I opened up, they sent me the shipment of albums fresh off the press for I Want to Be a Clone, and when I opened it up on the label, it said, for best results, play loud, which I didn't know they were going to do that. So I thought, well, that's nice. I think they're getting the spirit of this. And I was happy to be in that world for the first 3 or 4 albums. And then I think around that time, Christian music kind of became more institutionalized and decided that it really was primarily for being made for fellow Christians and for the church. And at that point, was probably when I lost a bit of interest and just thought maybe it's time to go do something else, which is when I started the band Chagall Guevara with a couple of like-minded friends.
Okay. And yeah, there was always something different you were doing. I've just been reading this book, Shaking the World for Jesus. Have you read that?
I'm not familiar with that.
Okay, it's about, it came out probably about 10, 15 years ago. But it's a look at evangelical art and culture from a non-evangelical. So it's kind of fascinating to me to see some kind of looking at the culture I grew up in with different eyes.
Right.
But they point out your work and the work that you did with Squint quite a bit when they're talking about music as kind of something different outside of that. That you kind of was, there was this line where you weren't the stereotypical Christian band, but you also weren't softening your lyrics. And you were, I still agree, there's this artistry in it too. Like your wordplay is so much fun in the songs. I love, like, I Want to Be a Clone. It's just, that's a funny song.
Right.
But listening to it again, I'm like, oh yeah, I've grown up in that culture where I'm not supposed to think for myself. I'm just supposed to, you know, do what they say and be the Christian they want. And it is funny, those still are resonant.
Yeah, it's funny and sad, I guess. But, I am not a particularly rebellious, I certainly wasn't a rebellious teen, and have not really ever had issues with Jesus. I've just had issues with the way American culture in particular has kind of twisted Christianity into a consumerist religion, and I'm probably more angry about that these days than I've been in a while. It's been kind of disheartening to see American Christianity turned into a blunt political force that seems more interested in power and the ends justifying the means than in transformation. So, yeah, that's funny. There are songs that are decades old that seem relevant today, and there are other songs that I would just soon go away.
What songs do you wish would go away? Is there anything you can't sing anymore?
There are so many. It would be harder to. there's a lot of them. I think when you're writing them, or when I'm writing them, when I was writing them at the time, anytime you have like pop culture references in a song, you recognize that that's going to date a song. And anytime you reference sort of specific things happening in culture and the news, that tends to date a song as well. And then there are other songs. There was a song on the Meltdown album called Meet the Press that I just don't think was a particularly well-written song. Sometimes it's lyrics that I never got quite right. Sometimes it's production that seems particularly dated. All of these songs, of course, were recorded at a certain time in a certain era with certain musical things going on, so you can't really avoid that. And then sometimes it's just, this song isn't as good as I wish it would have been.
Derek Webb has a saying, I've heard him say it a few times, it's when he gets up on stage, he's not the same person he was when he wrote whatever song he's singing.
Right.
And his faith has changed so much, and his perspective has changed so much. There's certain songs he just, his relationship with them is at the point where he can't sing them anymore. Do you have any like that? Has your faith perspective kind of shifted at all in the last 30 years or so? I mean, I guess everyone's faith does in 30 years, but...
Right. I think, you know, this is always a tricky thing to try and categorize yourself, but I would still consider myself in sort of the, I think Tim Keller refers to it as Orthodox Christianity,
mm-hmm.
with a small O. So I still fall into that classification. At the same time, I feel like I gave a lot of I'm trying to figure out how to best put this. I feel like I gave some Christian leaders the benefit of the doubt that in the last few years I don't think they deserved it. And so I feel I'm probably as angry as I've been in a long time, you know, not to get too political on you, but with Trump's election and with the amount of kind of old school evangelical supporters that he's had, you know, I do not like the man. I think he's kind of a despicable person. And, you know, I've been making fun of him for decades. And the fact that he's now our president and the fact that he was elected, you know, I understand we didn't have we had two bad choices, but it still defies imagination that he would have such outspoken support from Christian leaders. You know, I
no, we're
understand.
So yeah, we're
two evils argument, but that there are people that would actually go on record as supporting that guy as Christians, that kind of blows my mind.
Yeah, no, we're in the same place there. I grew up watching cartoons in the 80s where if they wanted shorthand of greed and excess, they did a caricature of Trump. It was always that. That was always that growing up. And, yeah. You know, now there are people who I respect, who I have learned from, who have been instrumental in my own faith walk. And they're saying, well, you know, nope, he's a godly man. I'm like, well, that doesn't line up with what I read from you 20 years ago. I and, you know, to the point where, you know, it's been family tension, too. Just,
right,
I come
right.
from a Christian family, and they're, oh, he's a godly man. He's better than the other one. And I'm like,
wow, yeah.
I don't know that's what I want to settle for as a Christian. I feel like you were kind of always, you know, in the middle, homeless, I guess might be the best way, kind of too liberal for the evangelical mainstream, too Christian for the liberals, but I feel like that's the place a lot of Christians should be.
Yes. You know, referring back to Tim Keller, who I admire a lot, he makes the point, a really good point, that, you know, Christians shouldn't be aligned with any political party because we're always going to be a mix of things that are supported and offensive to both parties,
mm-hmm.
and we don't have a political home, and probably never did. But and the degree that we align ourselves with, you know, temporal powers is, I'm afraid, the degree that we lose our ability to be salt and light in our culture.
Yeah, I totally agree with that. I think people forget that the context of Christianity has so often been like an underdog and not a people who are in power. And
right.
When you start wanting power, it's kind of antithetical to when you worship a man who willingly died.
Yes, that's right. Yeah, I think the church has always worked best when it was functioning as the underdog.
Now, you mentioned it's gotten you angrier than you've been in a while, and I think a lot of people feel this way. As an artist, do you feel something kind of roiling up in you, like, I've got to tackle this some way, or are you kind of like, no, people can...
Yeah, I mean, I do, but you know, when that impulse can also create some really didactic messes of songs. So it's a tricky one. You know, when I was starting out, I would have jumped right on this. You can make a pretty good argument that the I Predict 1990 album was mostly based on the Oliver North hearings, and here's a guy who claims to be a Christian and, you know, is right up front about lying all the time and seems proud of it. And for those of you who were around back then, but I think at that point I was starting to get my craft together enough as a songwriter to where hopefully most of those songs weren't too didactic. So that's always the trick is, you know, you want to create stuff that has punch, but you also want to create stuff that isn't that doesn't smell of propaganda or
right.
a strict agenda. So it's a tough one. You know, the Goliath album, I think, was informed by some of those same currents, but I don't think we veered into kind of overt propaganda in any of the songs.
No, it feels more like cultural critique, and it's not. Yeah, it's not preachy. This is the world I see, which is the place for art. And Goliath is just a fun album too. I love that album. I do want to get back to this in a minute, but I do also think you moved on to producing after a while.
Yes.
And I actually co-host this podcast. We do interviews, but then we do an actual show where me and a co-host sit down and just kind of talk about whatever's on our mind. And it's Joe Yerke from The Insiders who produced an album with you, or Four Squints.
Of course, oh man. I could talk about The Insiders for days. I loved that band so much.
They were so much fun, yeah.
Working with them.
How did you come about them?
So I think with The Insiders, we had been, at that point, I started producing in the early 90s, and a lot of it was just, you know, when you're a recording artist, especially, you know, I mean, when you're a band, maybe it's a little bit different, but outside of the Chagall Gavar experience, it was always my album and my career. And it's just exhausting waking up every day thinking, okay, what am I going to do to promote myself today? And what am I going to do to make other people want to promote me? And there's just so much self-promotion that goes on. It's very hard to square with, I found it very hard to square with my Christian faith. And I admire, there are people that do it well, and I hopefully didn't do it too poorly, but it was just always a source of tension and angst. So when I started producing other bands, I really enjoyed it because I was there to serve them, and not that I didn't have plenty of opinions, and not that I, you know, wouldn't try to steer them away from the things that I thought would be mistakes, but ultimately it was their album, and I was trying to help them make the best version of their album that they could. So, and then when I started the record label, it was because 6 months on the Richer had approached me about producing their next album, and then their label went bankrupt, and ultimately the probably the best and only way to get this album out was to actually start a record label. So we had that album out, and it was doing, you know, it was doing okay. It was not burning up the charts at that point. And I was looking for the next signing, and somehow, I can't remember who it was that told me about this band, The Insiders. And they were working on at that point they'd already made a couple albums, and they were working on a project with Gene Eugene called Scalleluia.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't remember if I just heard some demos or what, but I just thought it sounded fantastic. And somehow was able to sign them just for that album, and you know, we had a blast working together. And their album was a big hit. And
yeah,
frankly, a lot of the reason that a lot of the success with Sixpence None the Richer was directly related to their album coming out and being such a hit that it kept it allowed momentum for the label to keep going until the single Kiss Me on Sixpence's album finally broke through. So I look back on that era with great fondness, and on the band, of course, with great fondness. They were really fun live, and that album I still think is really strong.
Yeah, it's a fun album. My dad, like I said, he led the music at our church, and he was kind of skeptical about Christian rock. I remember I wanted a DC Talk album for my birthday one year, and he said he'd get it for me, but he also got me the GLAAD Orchestra album. I'm like 13. I'm like, Dad, I'm not listening to GLAAD. But he played trombone, and he wanted to do a worship night at church. So they had the songbook for Scallaluia.
Right.
And so he put together a little ska band at our little Baptist church because he loved it. It reminded him of Chicago.
That's great.
Yeah, it was fun.
He played trombone because there's, you know, as a trombone player, I could tell you there's just not that many opportunities to play trombone in something that's hip.
No. And he's not a hip guy, so he made it feel good. Right. You were also really involved with the Newsboys. I remember you did, what was it, Going Public and Take Me to the Leader with them, right?
Yes, yeah, and the Not Ashamed album before that.
Okay.
Three albums, and then I came back and did additional albums later, but those were the three in a row that probably more than anything else kind of established me as a producer.
And I still think they hold up. The lyrics in those are so much fun. Like, Breakfast is still a song I like crank up for my kids.
Oh, nice.
Because it's just a fun little song, and you can definitely, when you go back and listen to your albums and then you compare it to the Newsboys of that era, you can definitely see, it's like when Conan O'Brien would write for The Simpsons, you can always pick out his stuff, and you can pick out your lyrics. It was just so much fun to listen to, and still a lot of fun.
Thanks.
But you also did your first film with them, which is kind of the thing I want to get into talking about now, because I'm a film guy, I'm a film critic on the side. And I still remember having that Down Under the Big Top, VHS.
Right.
And what's funny is, you know, I knew enough as a teenager to know a lot of Christian movies don't really have a lot of art to them. There's not a lot of thought put into composition or anything. And I remember there's this shot, it's still ingrained in me. I remember this just little shot of them frying donuts. And the camera shooting up through the fryer and their heads are like peeking in.
Right.
And I just remember thinking, wow, you don't see that on McGee and Me. And and I just, that was a lot of fun. What got you into that? I knew you were doing some short films with Squint.
Right, yeah. So I think that came out right before we started the label. And I studied music as a major and film as like a minor at Colorado University in Boulder. And so I got a recording contract not long after I left college. But I wanted to keep a foot in filmmaking, so first I started doing my own music videos, and then I started getting hired to do other people's music videos. And those who do a lot of music videos, we think we're making, like, you know, mini movies, but in fact all we're doing is adding images to a pre-existing soundtrack. And so at a certain point I thought, man, I want to try something else, but I don't want to try to jump into a, you know, like a feature movie. I'm not ready to do that yet. So I thought that would maybe be a good kind of hybrid medium step where I pitched the record label on the idea, and, you know, it would be like an hour-long kind of mini-movie, but it would give me the chance to work with dialogue and, you know, sound and all the things that you don't do when you're making music videos. And thankfully, the label was into it, and the band was into it, and it was crazy. It was like a 5-day shoot or something like that. And the first day, I think we ended up going, I don't know, we were supposed to go 12 hours and we went like 18 or something, which blew the next day. And So I learned a lot on that process, but I look back on it with great fondness. It was really fun.
I remember it being fun. I remember thinking, and it's been decades since I've seen it, but I remember even then thinking, oh, it's kind of like the Monkees,
you know? Yes.
And I loved the sense of humor about that. And you still collaborate quite a bit with Peter Furler, right?
That's right. Yeah. Yeah.
He's in the perfect foil.
The label is like it'll be like an hour-long Monkees episode, right?
Okay.
And you know, as long as we worked the music in from Take Me to Your Leader, we just finished it, so I think we made this before the album actually came out, and worked in most of the songs into it, and you know, the band was always game. I gotta hand it to Newsboys on many fronts. First of all, I think Peter, who we'll talk about now, is just one of the best melody writers anywhere. I think he's as good as anybody, and you see that all through the Newsboys' career. They just have these really great melodies, which were a blast to write lyrics to because the melodies were already so memorable. But then the other thing about Newsboys is they just worked harder than anybody else. So when people ask me, you know, what's the key to success, it's really not talent. I mean, there's got to be talent there, and the Newsboys had talent, although it's developed over time. When I first started working with them, it was sort of in a still budding place. But ultimately, they just worked harder than just about any other band I'd come across, and that was and still is, I think, the difference maker for them. And Peter was just man, he was just a really dedicated, hardworking guy, and we got on great, and we still get on great. And so, you know, so doing the band with him, the Perfect Foil, was a blast because he hadn't played drums for a while, and really liked the idea of just being the drummer in the band. Although, of course, we used a lot of his music ideas and kind of melody snippets as starting points for a lot of the songs on the album.
Now, when you guys would perform, did you get to use his Newsboys drum kit? The flip upside down drum kit, or?
No, that's because it was mostly clubs, so it wouldn't have even fit.
I remember being at the Fox Theater in Detroit, which is this theater where you go see Broadway shows. You don't go see a rock show.
Sure, yeah, yeah.
And we're up in the balcony watching it, and the whole thing was just shaking, and I thought we were going to, like, collapse out of there.
I know. Well, they kept using it. You know, they would use it well past the point of danger. So I think at one point it like froze up midway. This was kind of early on in the history of the revolving drum kit. And I don't know what happened. You had to crawl out of it or something like that. But I was always concerned that something bad was going to happen. But they managed to survive.
It's funny thinking how big that whole scene was back in, like, the 90s or something. Like, I tell a lot of friends, I'm like, oh, yeah, I grew up listening to Christian rock. And I'm like, oh, so you'd, like, go to church and see bands? I'm like, no, you don't understand. They used to sell out arenas for this.
That's right.
I'm like, I saw DC Talk at the Palace 3 or 4
right.
times, sold out house. And, yep. And, like, they were big productions.
Right.
So, I mean, I don't know what gets lost when you're doing that, but it's still, it's a lot of fun.
No, it was a lot of fun, you know, a lot of spectacle and big touring machines. At one point, I remember reading in Variety, they were talking about the, you know, top Australian money makers, and it was like Mel Gibson, Nicole Kidman, and Newsboys, and then AC/DC.
Oh, wow.
Crazy. Yeah.
I think they were at every festival I ever went to.
Yeah,
like, every festival they would play. One thing that's kind of never caught on the same way, though, is the Christian movie industry.
Yes.
Which, I don't want to say you've been involved with that, because I don't know if you would consider your films the type of faith-based movie. You're not making God's Not Dead.
Right. No, but I mean, the first movie that I made was, I got to back up a little bit. When I started the Squint label, I also, part of the funding was like $1 million to make my first movie. This is
okay.
The Down Under the Big Top had been done, and I felt ready. And the idea I pitched was kind of like a postmodern fairy tale. It was going to have animation in it. The same guy that did the Insiders, He Has Made Me Glad animated video, Jonathan Richter, was going to do the stop motion animation, and we worked like 3 years on the script. I worked on it with a couple of friends, and when we finally did a table reading of this screenplay, at the end of the table reading, I realized this movie is unfilmable, and if I did film it, it would be unwatchable. And so at that point, I thought, man, I gotta come up with something. I gotta start from scratch on something else. And it's the old adage, write what you know. And I thought it would be interesting to write a movie set in, like a black and white buddy movie set in two churches. So that first movie, The Second Chance, actually had Michael W. Smith as its star. Mm-hmm. And you know, I had a blast working with him, and but it really did fit more in kind of the faith-based film world. And the second movie, Blue Like Jazz, does kind of elliptically, just because it's based on a, you know, best-selling memoir that was really popular in among a lot of Christians. But the faith-based film world, for the most part, really wanted nothing to do with that movie. They you know, it just didn't fit in well. It wasn't a movie that was a family movie, and we managed to squeak by with a PG-13 rating. We thought it was could end up being rated R.
Really?
It was just a story that was there was no way to tell that story accurately without the reality of what the setting was.
Yeah.
And so that movie, I don't really consider it a faith-based movie, largely because it doesn't fit well within that genre.
Well, the reason I was so excited to talk to you is Blue Like Jazz. I loved that movie.
Oh, thanks.
I had read Don's book years ago, and it's one I'll pull out every few years because I think it's really good, especially if you've grown up in the evangelical subculture, to kind of you kind of open your brain a little bit. And yeah. It lets you breathe a little bit. But it's funny because a lot of people will ask me, right, because I do the film reviews and they know I'm a Christian, they'll often right. ask me about, oh, well, what is this thing with Christian movies? I mean, most of them aren't good. But then they always ask me, what about God's Not Dead? And right. that's like the film I'm sick of being asked about because I'm like, it's really not good.
Right.
And it kind of offends me. It makes me angry. But I'll turn them, I'll say, if you want to see what you can do with that idea, though, you need to watch Blue Like Jazz, because it's really a similar idea in many ways. It's yes. a Christian going to a liberal college, and I think what your film does that I think is so remarkable, none of the characters in there feel like they're there simply to get saved.
Right. Right?
Like, there's a lot of love for every single character. They're not just the stock, here's the lesbian who gets saved. I mean, it's about learning to love people whether they share your faith or not and realizing we're just as flawed.
Yes.
And I was really bummed that didn't, like, become a God's Not Dead size hit, because it's one I've wanted to bring out to my churches. But, yes, they see the PG-13 rating, and they're not always too excited about that. But what was kind of the reaction from the Christian community with that movie? Because I know you premiered at South by Southwest.
Right. Yeah, I mean, it was such an odd experience, because we when I first pitched Don on making the movie, I didn't know him at that point. He had some familiarity with me based on my musical history, and so at that point the book was not a bestseller, but I pitched him on I was looking for the next project, and someone gave me that book, and I read it over the Christmas holiday. And as you know, when you read that book, you don't put it down and think, oh, I see, oh, this will make a great movie. I'll see this movie
yeah,
in my head.
Yeah.
It's more like a collection of essays, but there's that kind of narrative thread that runs through it, and there's this, those who have read the book know about this scene that takes place in Don and his friends build a confession booth on campus. And I knew I wanted to make the movie for that scene, and so my pitch to Don was, I want to end the movie with that scene, and but I think your character, instead of being a 30-year-old writer who lives off campus and audits classes at Reed College, I think your character needs to be a 19-year-old college student who lives the experience. And Don was, you know, fully on board with that idea, And he ended up working on the screenplay with me and my longtime collaborator, Ben Pearson. And we had a great time writing it. And while we were writing the screenplay, the book became like a really big bestseller.
Mm-hmm.
And so I just assumed it was going to be easy to get the movie funded. And, man, I just could not have been more wrong. And we pitched it to like literal hundreds of potential investors, just about all of whom were fellow Christians who believed in the value of, you know, cultural engagement. But they would read the screenplay and they were like, well, this isn't family friendly. It was like, well, no, you know, a family friendly movie of this version would be ridiculous. You know, it's just, it needs the reality of that environment for it to mean anything. And, we just could not get the money raised. And, I mean, we worked for like 4 years trying to raise the money and the screenplay. You know, I mean, we kept working on the screenplay and tinkering with it, but it really, the first draft was pretty strong to begin with. And, you know, I knew I didn't want to take it to any kind of a studio or situation where I just didn't think the movie would benefit from having other people being able to say what the final cut would be, or it's this and it's not this. So I knew that was like a bottom line for me. But, you know, we finally, there was a really great guy up in Seattle who was willing to put up like $500,000, and then an LA entity was going to put up another $250,000, and I was so desperate at this point after 4 years, I was finally like, I don't care, I'm just going to make it for that money, and we'll figure out the post-production later, which of course you're never supposed to do. And the day before we were going to open up our production office, the entity in LA dropped out.
Mm-hmm.
So at that point, I went to, you know, I called Don up, who had been a great supporter and been so helpful and patient, and told him what had happened, because obviously we couldn't go forward. And he was understandably bummed out and announced the next day on his blog, which now he's a pretty famous guy at this point, that the movie's not going to happen. I think he just felt like, you know, I need to do this for Steve as a kind of like a mercy killing, because I don't want my friend to suffer anymore. And then, you know, the response was all these people writing back saying, oh, you got to make this movie. We want to see this, you know, and I'll get my friends together and we can give you $100, or, you know, all these people wanted to help, but of course nobody had the kind of money it would take to get the movie actually made. And two young guys in Franklin, Tennessee, both in their early 20s, they pitched us on doing a Kickstarter campaign. And, at that point, Kickstarter wasn't a thing. And
yeah.
So I went and met with them, and, you know, I checked out Kickstarter, and I liked the idea of Kickstarter a lot. But there was, at that point, you know, no movie had raised more than, like, $50,000, and we needed to raise $250,000 in 30 days, or we were going to lose our lead actor. He had to go back to work on True Blood. And so the clock was ticking, and I told them, you know, I don't think this is going to work, and I'm not ready for this public of a humiliation when it doesn't. And they said, do you have any better ideas? And I didn't. So we launched the Save Blue Light Jazz campaign, and then, you know, it was like the biggest crowdfunded project in history at that point, and raised like $350,000 in 30 days, and it was just so much fun and such a wonderful time, and made it possible for us to make the movie. And we got a distributor fairly quickly once it was finished, Roadside Attractions, who I had loved, and they had, you know, put out some of my favorite movies, or more kind of an art house distributor. And I think we just assumed, because of the response to the Kickstarter campaign, that there was a bigger audience for the movie than there ended up being. You know, we were so grateful. We did a tour all across the country showing the movie, screening the movie for all of our Kickstarter supporters, and, you know, maybe in retrospect, we should have waited until opening weekend for that. it just didn't catch on the way we thought it would.
I think right now it feels like it, I appreciate it even more now when we're in this culture where Christians and everyone else and Christians are screaming at each other so much.
Right.
And here's a movie that doesn't end with an altar call. It doesn't end with, you know, the Pat conversion scene. It's two guys talking.
Right.
And I feel like right now that's what we need in our culture is people to just sit and say, hey, here's where I'm coming from. Here, where are you coming from? What's our common ground? And how do we move forward? And I love it when it pops up on Netflix because I always can kind of push people toward it. It does pop up on Netflix every once in a while.
Yeah. Oh, thanks, Chris. I appreciate that.
But I feel like you said with music, it's very easy to get didactic. And I think it's the same thing with movies.
Yeah.
But I feel like there's also room for it to be prophetic. Because I feel like what Blue Light Jazz does in a lot of places, and The Second Chance even, it's kind of saying, you know, we know our audience, a lot of them are going to be believers. Let's show them where maybe we're a little bit flawed, and maybe that piques their heart somewhere. I think there's a place for art like that. I feel like the idea with so much faith-based film is this idea that everyone believes they're making films for non-believers who are going to come pray to the screen afterwards.
Right.
And I'm like, no, maybe the best thing, because film works best when it's prompting questions. And maybe the best thing to do is you're making the movie that's going to send people out for coffee after to talk about things, and or it's going to stick with them. I don't know. How do you? Because you're a film professor, right?
Yeah. I'm actually at Lipscomb University in Nashville. I'm their filmmaker in residence, and I've started teaching some classes. And frankly, I really love it. I was like, there's very few jobs in life where you can get in a room with a bunch of, you know, late teens and early 20s, and they have to listen to you. The only way they're going to get a grade is if they listen to you. So, I really like this gig.
Well, what's your perspective on where faith-based film is, and how do you feel faith best fits in film? Like, when have you seen it done right?
Right. I think there are, it's not a perfect analogy, but in some ways it's similar to where Christian music started out. And that in its early stages it was well-meaning, but, was a little, maybe the art was not as developed and ended up coming off oftentimes more as kind of advertisements for Christianity. And but you also had, you know, some really great artists come along as well. The film side of things is trickier because it just costs so much money. Even an independent movie costs so much money. And so a lot of these movies end up, I think, kind of being made by committee, and the filmmaker isn't necessarily, the director isn't necessarily the one who's ultimately deciding what it is and what it isn't. It's a producer or it's a producer committee or something like that. And they cost so much that I think, you know, lots of times the investors want not just a return on their money, but a return on, they want things that movies don't necessarily deliver well. This is a longer conversation, but Hitchcock believed that the two things that typically couldn't be illustrated very well on the screen were lovemaking and prayer. it's a difficult thing to go into a faith-based movie to begin with.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know, this is going back a ways, but Robert Duvall did a movie called Tender Mercies,
okay.
20 years ago maybe. And it starts off with him drunk in a rundown motel, and he wakes up the next day, and the widow who runs it, who has got a young son, she tells him he can stay there, and if he'll work for his board. And so he sobers up and goes to work and falls in love with the widow and ends up going to church with her and getting baptized and becoming a Christian. But that's early on in the movie. And then instead of like a typical faith-based movie would go, where everything then goes right, everything in his life starts going wrong. And it's just a really powerful movie, but it's not all leading up to a conversion.
Mm-hmm.
Because I think Hitchcock would say conversions are hard to put on screen.
Yeah.
And that's in, as much as anything else, that's the biggest challenge in a faith-based movie, is it's just a hard, we believe that, I believe that God changes people and transforms people, but that is not a very dramatic premise to put on screen. It's called Deus Ex Machina. It goes back to the Greeks when they made plays, and the bad plays had this thing happen where the gods would be lowered down on an elevator, elevated stage down to where the mortals were, and they would sort things out. And this term, that's where this term Deus Ex Machina comes from, and it's inherently undramatic. It's something that dramatists know to avoid at all costs. But that's the problem with, most faith-based movies, is you have that happening. You have God coming down and sorting things out. And so it's a tough one to do no matter how good you are, I think.
Yeah.
Only a handful of them that work.
Yeah. Yeah, I think of something like the movies that really I felt kind of conveyed faith very well and powerfully. And I'm thinking of like Tree of Life or Silence. Both films that audiences really do not do well with.
Right.
But yeah, because it is. You're really trying to visualize something that's so internal and transcendent.
Yeah. And a movie like Hacksaw Ridge works because we're seeing the results of that character's faith as opposed to leading up to a conversion experience.
Yeah.
So there are movies like that, and I would have named those two as well, that just do it beautifully and powerfully, but it's because the dramatic premise is different.
Yeah.
That's always going to be the tough thing about more kind of traditional faith-based films is that's just a hard premise to pull off.
There was a film earlier this year called The Women's Balcony. I don't know if you've heard of it or see it. It was very small. It's actually the highest grossing film in Israel. It's a Israeli movie, and it's about a Jewish community, what happens when the women's section of their synagogue breaks. And they bring in a rabbi who's a little more conservative, says some things that offend the congregation. And it kind of gets into this whole religious community, and it's a funny movie. It's a very light movie. But it really captures this dynamic in religious communities. And I'm like, oh, I would love to see something like that about, like, the Baptist community. Because it's its own little world. And I was just thinking about that movie. Do you have any hopes to direct again? Or?
Yeah, so I've been working on a political comedy with a couple of friends.
Oh, really?
And how could you make a political movie these days and it not be a comedy? So,
or a horror movie.
Well, yeah, there you go. But it's really not a faith-based movie. I'm not sure I would tackle one of those again. Just for a number of reasons. But I mean, never say never. I was talking to my friend Scott Derrickson not too long ago, and he's did The Exorcism of Emily Rose, which you certainly wouldn't classify as a faith-based movie in most regards, but man, what a great movie, and a really scary movie as well. And then he went on to do a movie, Sinister, which is even scarier, and then just did Doctor Strange. And I was talking to him about how his Christian faith ends up, you know, infusing these movies, mm-hmm. almost whether he wants them to or not.
Yeah, and, yeah, even Doctor Strange.
Right, right. So I think that says a lot about the filmmaker is, you know, these things kind of become part of the, hopefully become part of the creative process, and they work their way into stories, but they don't have to be done in such a, you know, didactic way, I think.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he talked about an Exorcism of Emily Rose, they got two lawyers, right? It's a courtroom drama for a lot of it, and this priest is on trial for a girl who performed an exorcism, and the girl ends up dying. So the priest is on trial, I think, for murder.
Mm-hmm.
And the prosecuting attorney is like a, you know, Methodist, quote-unquote, God-fearing person who is the skeptic. And the skeptic, who is prosecuting the priest, and the priest's lawyer is like a skeptical non-believer who's being forced to reconsider all her prior assumptions. And man, I love that. I love just the way he just set it up just with the plot and with the characters and flipping the script. And we need more of that.
Yeah, I dig that movie a lot. Yeah, more movies about faith. Maybe not as many faith-based movies.
Right, right.
Well, listen, thank you. Thank you so much for taking the time to talk. I have loved this.
Oh, thank you, Chris. Man, the time's gone by fast. It's been a blast talking to you, and give Joe my best.
I will definitely do that. I'd love to have you back on to talk movies again someday.
Oh, man. Well, this has really been fun.
All right. Thank you, Steve.
All right. Take care.
You too.